Somebody's late, so supposed to be here. Jeff is here.
You're always late.
And he's late. Oh, it's traffic. Traffic in a small town. David's here, but he's late. As always. Anyway, thanks everybody for being here tonight, as always. And yeah, I forgot to set up my camera on YouTube. For my YouTube channel, because I, you know, record it and talk about it later on and all that stuff. So, and then I, you know, I put it on YouTube.
Mm-hmm. It's live.
That's what I do. Mm-hmm. And there he goes, taking my cord out of my thing. He acts like he runs this place. Like he owns the place.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. If anybody comes to the Wix site, Kat, I'll let you know. Yeah, that's where the, if you want to hear the radio side, thenightbreedshow.wix.com/ghostgetter, jackaloperadio.com, that's where we are, Facebook, keyword, we're on there, Facebook, Ghostgetter, tell your friends, tell your neighbors, tell your mother, patreon.com/ghostgetter, YouTube/ghostgetter, Twitter, banging my microphone, messing up my radio stuff, yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much.
We're good. We're good.
We're okay. Thank you for, you know, making my ears crappier than ever before. I appreciate that. Okay. So, what is... Okay.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
We could have gotten that taken care of if you'd been
yeah,
here
really.
10 minutes ago.
I know. We would have fixed the mic if you were here on time. That would have been lovely. No, let me just gonna turn his mic down while he, you know, while he adjusts it.
Foam.
Yeah, because all I can hear is rumbling around and blowing in my ear like he's some kind of pervert.
Hello.
Yeah, he's blowing in my mic like he's some kind of perv.
Yeah.
I don't know whether to throw him out or get turned on.
My goodness.
Anyway.
Sick bastard.
Hey, children.
Watch it now. We have children.
Jeff is in the room.
Jeff's.
Oh, plural. Sick bastards.
Yes. How dare you say you as in one person? There's more people here. It's all fair and balanced.
Fair.
Just like, you know, Bill O'Reilly. Oh, yeah, he don't have a job no more. Oh, yeah, and also... Chicago Blackhawks got swept.
Oh, yeah. That was good.
They didn't win.
They thought they were good.
Yeah, they thought so, but they weren't. You're nowhere near the microphone, by the way. The mic is up there. You're talking into the bar.
Okay. I thought I'd maybe wear this on my nose.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm good now.
It is that time of the year, you know, when you're supposed to wear the red nose.
Oh, that's that time of the month.
Yeah. Okay, just I don't know what he's doing.
So anyway, it's on the agenda, anyway.
21.
Oh, 21 agendas.
Yeah, talking about blackjack.
Is this on?
I don't know. Does the speaker sound like it?
Yeah, it's on.
See, Jamie's my producer. He can throw you out.
That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Ain't that right?
Strong arm.
You throw him out.
Producer?
Yeah, that's right.
Why don't you produce some income around here?
Yeah, instead of eating it up.
Yeah, that's right.
Walking around here without a shirt on. What's up with that?
It's radio.
No shirt, no shoes, no service.
It's radio.
Except for YouTube.
Yeah.
Don't hit my mic, my camera, by the way. Jamie keeps knocking it. He's good. I shouldn't have said nothing. Now he's going to go over there and hit it.
There
anyway,
he is with his
I had to look
glasses
up,
on.
I had to look up what this Agenda 21 was. I don't know why in the world this thing keeps doing that. Anyway, I had to look up what this Agenda 21 was. And, you know, I already knew pretty much about all the stuff that was going on. I didn't know they had a certain name for it. Because I knew that there were a lot of things going on over the last 10 years. And mm-hmm. how it started getting worse.
Mm-hmm.
And people were literally, if you connect the stuff like the, which I have a hard time believing, the closed, empty Walmarts, using them for FEMA camps. I don't know if I believe that. Walmart's just sucking, and that's why they're closing. Yeah,
that's weird.
But, yeah, they're all of a sudden there's certain Walmarts across the country that are closing for no reason, and they're saying it's plumbing problems. That's why would you close like a certain amount of them all over the country and say it's plumbing problems?
That's weird.
But they're being completely gutted. No one really knows why.
Yeah.
And they're also being protected. Now, I don't understand that part. I don't understand. I can understand when somebody's saying that at their Jade Helm 15 by the end of this, by the end of June, 3 years ago. But they keep giving, updating the months every year. So I stopped believing in that stuff.
Yeah.
A lot of what they're saying, I stopped believing in the stuff that they're talking about. But the only issue I have, which I can't figure out for the life of me, and why my headphones not working on my left side, is when something like that happens and somebody's investigating a Walmart, yeah, why all of a sudden within 2 minutes, a black helicopter flies overhead and is watching the person that's looking inside the Walmart? The same thing happened with this guy was investigating this old railroad trestle. This old railroad, it was a building that was repairing old trains, but it's been abandoned for years, and some of the trains are still there, some of them are not. But he was investigating it because he was claiming it was a FEMA camp. The reason he said he was claiming it was a future FEMA camp is because they built fences on the outside perimeter of this building, and the barbed wire was to keep the people from coming out, not going in. Yeah. It was facing the other direction. So he started getting nervous about it and started investigating it, and he noticed that over time that they were building guard towers. So why are they building guard towers in this big giant building? So as he's walking around and he's talking about this, I'm sure you can find it on YouTube, all of a sudden, this black helicopter is flying overhead and is watching him. He's circling around the building, watching this guy taking camera footage of it. And which makes sense, because it's like, well, you can complain about the FEMA stuff all day long and say it's BS and it's all made up and it's conspiracy theory, this and that. But what's with the helicopter? What's with the barbed wire fence? What's with the guard towers in an abandoned building? I'm starting to see a lot of this. I noticed downtown Dallas in the area of 35, this was probably around 2010, this area between 35 and where all that splits off with 35, 75, 45, then the Mixmaster, down below the bridge there was this area that had barbed wire fence, but there was nothing there.
Yeah.
It was just a fence. Nothing inside of it, nothing in between it.
Wasn't there to keep the homeless out, was it?
There was nothing in it.
Oh.
It was just a square fence.
Obviously,
and grass in the middle. And I'm thinking, why do they need to build a fence with nothing in it?
Damn.
Unless they're trying to keep people in there, but the barbed wire was facing inward, not outward.
Damn.
And I'm thinking, why would they make something like that? Maybe to rattle up homeless people? It was probably the size of maybe 50 yards. Half of a football field.
Yeah. I remember the train incident, the boxcars, years and years ago. I think you told me about it, where there was these boxcars were being placed in a way that it was looking like a camp. I don't remember. It was so long ago.
Train going by that looked like boxcars. It looked like something from World War II.
I can't remember that. But I believe that there's always been a plan in this country, always has been a plan in this country, to move large groups of people into certain areas if they need to. They failed with Katrina because they couldn't do anything about it except put them in the stadiums. But I remember a long time ago, back in the late 70s, I got involved with a group, but I wasn't a part of the group, that they were the, I'm trying to remember, I can't remember the groups. A group that didn't pay taxes. They were
outlaws.
Well, yeah, they've got their groups all over like that. Like the Texas something. They've got a group here in Texas like that.
It was a trilateral commission.
The people that don't pay taxes.
Yeah, there was a trilateral commission.
The Sharpton group.
they came up with a theory, and I don't know if it's true or not. They said that most of your prisons that are built near Air Force bases. And the theory is that if you have to fly people in from other countries or fly people out, large groups of people, you could house them in those prisons. It wouldn't say a whole lot for the prisoners because they'd probably be shot and then the cells be set up for other prisoners.
Well, did you know I heard that there's three that they built in Texas that are not being used?
Yeah.
Why would they build three prisons and not
I don't
use
know,
them?
But it may be, again, part of that theory they said that you'll always see in this country a place for large groups of people to be placed. One of them, they said, was stadiums.
Yeah.
And, you know, and prisons. And Cowboy they said...
Cowboy Stadium could fit a whole city in there.
They said that... what else they said? They said that the way... If our country were set up or attacked and, say, the nuclear weapon was dropped on the White House, that the post office, postmaster general, would be part of control of the sections where people live according to your zip code. That you, if something happened, you are to remain in your zip code. And postmaster general would put people up to control your areas or your situation, such as mailman.
Yeah.
He says it's already set up. This was back in the late 70s. This was set up so that if something happened to our country, there would still be law and order, and law and order would go to the postmaster general, who would control each one of the zip codes.
So the guy in
makes
the,
sense, but
so the guy in the dark blue shorts is actually the evil guy. No other dogs are.
No, that's the guy that's going to keep you under control.
He's the gatekeeper.
He's the gatekeeper.
No wonder dogs chase him around.
And they were saying that, you know, in the future you'll have your hand stamped with your zip code on it. That will be what makes you, you know, get in and out of that particular area. You have to show your zip code.
Hmm.
But it's interesting, this theory of large groups of people being put in stadiums, things like that. Well, look what happened in New Orleans. Putting all those people in that stadium was a disaster because they didn't have anybody in there to control the people or the bathrooms.
A person could call it a conspiracy theory all day long, but if you're smart and you understand the words of what they're saying and how they're saying it, why they're saying, especially in the city meetings and things like that, you start to ask yourself, what are you talking about? And then you got people that actually ask the questions and they'll say the dumbest things, but they're talking about making a city to where stack and pack buildings and bicycle routes, bicycle lanes that are larger than the car lanes, and how they're trying to eliminate vehicles and eliminate urban areas and trying to keep the population in a certain
Just keep the population
section.
Under control.
Right. And so there's a guy that was and people that were going into these meetings, these city meetings, and we're not talking just in California alone, but this is going all over the country because this guy is taking a hidden camera down these roads to show these stack and pack apartment buildings that are being built that are massively being built right now.
Yeah.
And we actually have the same apartment complexes near American Airlines Center downtown. The same, it looks like the same setup, the same color. It's almost like the guy that owns the layout, the blueprint for this. And even when I went to Lubbock last week, and I'm hearing about McDougal's the guy who used to be mayor, and he owns a lot of property in the city. He will clean out the poor neighborhoods and put up these stack and pack apartment complexes, which they consider to be Texas Tech students live there. Now, come on, there's more apartments than students, okay? But he's shoving all these people out of these areas that are poor, and the same thing's happening in downtown Dallas. It's basically pushing out all the people and pushing them into another certain area. It's control of where you want to put this group and where you're going to put that group.
I've always believed, too, that and the government has tried to control race relations, like with our black people, by making sure we get them out of the white neighborhoods and put them in Section 8 housing.
Yeah.
So that's like the dangling the carrot. Put them all in Section 8 housing, and then we can control them. And my thought was, you know, if you want to help these people out, put a university or two-year college there near the Section 8 housing or something to help these people out. But no, that's not the idea. The idea is to push them into a corner and dangle the carrot, the cheap carrot, and that's where the people will go. You could work at McDonald's and part-time and still live in Section 8 housing. That's just a way to put people, control people. I know, we used to live in it.
Yeah, and they talk about also dumbing down society. Yeah. I mean to point to him when I said that. But
what?
Well, if you're wearing glasses, you can compensate.
Dumbed down society, like turning the educational system into talking about more of the environment rather than teaching kids to learn. And I've actually heard some of these city people saying, we're trying not to teach, the education system isn't about teaching children to learn anymore.
Yeah.
It's about teaching them about the environment. And I'm thinking, that sounds like pre-programming people, kind of like what Hitler did to the youth back in the day in Germany. We're almost seeing the exact same thing.
Yeah.
And if you start up another generation of people and dumb them down, such as what's coming after the millennials, or part of what you're saying to millennials, which makes sense to me now, why there are so many people are screaming bloody murder after Trump wins the election.
Yeah.
And you're asking yourself, how can people be that ignorant?
Naive.
And then you look and you understand what they're doing to society, and you think to yourself, now that makes sense to me, why this is going on. It makes perfect sense. So here's, I'm going to play this while he's off and knocking my... Knock my camera over. But here's a one of the some people going in these undercover city meetings, and the crazy stuff that these people are trying to convince the public of what they're trying to do.
The Holy Grail of conservation in California. My name is Warren Whitlock. I am the Associate Administrator for Civil Rights for the Federal Highway Administration. I'm on detail for Mr. Dumas with the Secretary's office, helping put together this series of measures throughout the 11 regions of the country. Secretary Fox issued a draft study earlier this year called Beyond Traffic, a framework for the next 30 years of what the different transportation implications are going to be.
Transportation is literally the road to our future. As part of a larger mega region, Long Beach is attracting non-driving millennials, these thought of coming in, and immigrants who make up the great use of our light rail and our growing bicycle infrastructure.
First of all, it's great to be in Long Beach, California, in the Southern California mega region.
And some of the things that are doing, kind of cutting edge, really should be closely evaluated to determine how they potentially could fit into our options that we provide customers in the future for getting around Southern California and the other mega cities here in the United States.
Now, as Jim said, this is the third of our 11 mega region orders. And so we started off in Sacramento, we went to Phoenix, and now we're here in Southern California.
Okay.
Now, in our research, we identified 11 different mega regions throughout the country. And what we had determined a mega region is...
And that's one thing that I found really interesting. And I don't know if anybody's even brought it up. Which I've heard about this being told previously. I know that there's people that brought it up before, and I said to myself, that's not possible that they're splitting the United States up into certain sections, into 7 or 12 or whatever sections. Until this guy is in the public eye, he's standing there talking to the public, and he's talking about mega regions in the United States.
So we started off in Sacramento, we went to Phoenix, and now we're here in Southern California. Now, in our research, we identified 11 different mega regions throughout the country. And what we had determined a mega region is a center of economic, social, and infrastructure ties throughout the country. So one of the things you want to look at with this particular mega region is that you're projected to almost a 62% growth rate by 2050. That's a lot more people.
That's how we arrive at the 16,196 residential units that are currently being proposed.
The short answer to your question is we're growing as a city. SCAG is projecting that this city will add about 20,000 people in the next 20 years.
And the population projections for the next 20 years would bring, you know, another about 55,000 people, and depending on how big the average household would be, that could be another 15,000 or 18,000 new households.
Where are all these people going to be coming from? Because a lot of people are leaving California.
Yeah.
Businesses have left California. So where are we going to get the increase in population? And schools, enrollment, have been declining over the years. So where is everybody coming from?
So also birth rates. And what we are also observing is that fewer and fewer people are having fewer and fewer kids.
Fewer children being born. Fertility rates have been cut in half.
I would hope that
fertility rates will be cut in half.
I think that's already happened.
How is that? I would think if I was in the audience, I would ask him, excuse me, how are fertility rates going to be cut in half? I would be the most irritating person in the audience because I would nitpicking everything they say. How are fertility rates going to be cut in half? Could you answer that?
I think people are deciding that for themselves. They're not.
I don't know with this. Everybody wants this Planned Parenthood to work. But what the idiots are thinking, oh, it's to help women in their problems with births. Yeah. But if you look at behind the scenes with people that were having, you can go on YouTube and find it. And I've listened to it. I've watched it. I've talked about it on my show. If you go into the YouTube channels and you watch the people with undercover phone conversations they've had with Planned Parenthood, not one. And one guy has called almost every single one in the United States. Not one is used to help women. You know what their main agenda was? Their main agenda, according to them, is to Planned Parenthood, help people in the future with having babies and making
reproductive.
Sure that, but not one does that.
Health.
I still think a lot of it has to do with the economy. Since I've taught kids that are poor, when I used to teach them, I've noticed that if you were poor, I mean, really poor, for some weird reason, you're the ones that had the most kids. Because when you're poor, you get more government funding and more help. Whereas if you're not, you know better than to have six kids. You know, when we grew up, everybody, seems like everybody had six kids.
You're stereotyping.
Well, it's just interesting because when this guy was calling him undercover, right? This woman would say, well, we don't have that here. You may want to call another Planned Parenthood. And he would keep calling them, and they didn't have that. All they do is abortions.
Yeah.
And the real sad part is he was offering them to donate money if they could rid society of the black population. And they were more than willing to take the money to do that.
Oh, brother.
And I thought, this explains why they built so many of them in horrible neighborhoods.
Yeah.
This is why they done that.
That's another way to control
these
population.
Are little things that they're doing all over the country, and that, and you got, of course, Hillary Clinton was all for that.
But you know, honestly, unless you do medical or whatever, people are gonna hump as much as they want to. I don't care. Shoot, they're gonna do to do to diddle it.
But you know, controlled population.
We need to build in the center of America in a denser, walkable, more compact, and diverse way.
I am in West Covina in Southern California, and I'm over in what is going to be the new downtown area.
We are in Pasadena. They are building this construction site, Stack and Pack, Lux Apartments, coming soon. Look at this. They're doing this everywhere. Everywhere they're building Stack and Pack.
No, this is California. Oh. Now, here's something interesting, since we're on that subject of talking about ridding the population, according to Agenda 21. Yeah, what's the word for it? Cutting down the population,
sort of. Something like a genocide.
Listen to three times. Bill Gates was caught bringing this up, saying that he was planning on doing this.
First, we've got population. Now, the world today has 6.8 billion people. That's headed up to about 9 billion. Now, if we do a really great job on new vaccines, healthcare, reproductive health services. We could lower that by perhaps 10 or 15%. But there we see an increase of about 1.3. Now, if we do a really great job on new vaccines, healthcare, reproductive health services, we could lower that by perhaps 10 or 15%. We could lower that by perhaps 10 or 15%.
Here's another time when Bill Gates said
$10 billion over the next 10 years to make it the year of the vaccines. What does that mean exactly?
Well, over this decade, we believe unbelievable progress can be made, both inventing new vaccines and making sure they get out to all the children who need them. Uh-huh. We could cut the number of children who die every year from about 9 million to half of that if we have success on it. And the benefits there in terms of reducing sickness, reducing the population growth, it really allows the society to change.
Reducing the population growth.
Was it supposed to make it?
He just kind of stuck that in there.
Supposed to make them sterile?
Yeah, that's what he didn't say that, but he stuck that in there.
To take care of itself once you've made that intervention. And the benefits there in terms of reducing sickness, reducing the population growth, reducing the population growth.
Reducing population
this
growth.
One's,
but if we
how,
go back,
you should
listen
that
how
about
quick,
20 times.
Now listen how quick he, I think this is the one here, how quick he throws this one in.
Key metrics, which is, you know, what the foundation looks at on all
no,
this
not
stuff.
This, it'll be
can
the next
we
one.
Drop the number of children who die per year in half and get the reduction in sickness and population growth that comes with that? That is sort of front of mind all the time.
Reduction of population growth.
Get
let's move on.
The reduction in sickness and population growth that comes with that. That is sickness
yeah,
and
population. How quick they are.
We've seen now there's a type of foreign assistance for vaccines
that's
or for AIDS treatment that are incredibly effective. These are all about saving lives. And the good news is that as you make those breakthroughs, the population growth in the country goes down. These are all about saving.
How quick he said that.
Yeah.
The population growth in America goes down.
And
you
let's
can
move on to the next subject. And, you know, you think about it. Let's take the world as a whole. Somebody's
oh
got
gosh.
A pretty good handle on the population growth in Africa and places like that because those people are dying so fast. You don't. You just pull the food out from under them, and there you go.
Yeah.
But I think that movement in this country, populations that move in this country, people that move from neighborhood to neighborhood, it's all based on what I think is the dangling carrot theory.
Yeah.
If you want to move all the black people
explain
out
your,
of this
explain
neighborhood.
Explain your dangling carrots.
Oh, yeah, dangling carrots. If you want to move all the black people out of certain cities or certain places and neighborhoods, you build a Section 8 housing.
Oh, I was going to say.
And that's cheap.
You're on a fine line here.
Oh, come on. Let's all be.
Yeah.
I'm not going to be blind.
Be adults here.
I'm not blind. Come on. Just follow the carrots. Follow the carrots.
It's like a fine line here.
It's like when
you
go
to get rid of the black population.
No, I'm not saying get
do.
Rid of them. I'm saying move them. But let me ask you this. Here's an example. I can't understand this, but I see it
man.
All the time. Dairy Queen, no, Sonic, will have a little advertisement for a free ice cream
I
cone.
I knew they were evil.
Free ice cream cone. In fact, that's no big
called
deal, but
Agenda
you drive
21
down the
slushy.
Road, and you got policemen out in the street who are managing traffic because the cars are going around the block for this one little damn ice cream
yeah.
that's free. And I'm thinking, yeah. boy, you talk about drawing people
seem
out.
To have it's, what you call the Sonic free slushy between 5
exactly.
and 9.
Exactly.
21 mm-hmm. different flavors.
Right. And then every year 7-Eleven has this thing where you can come in and get your own slushy, but you can bring your own container
uh-huh.
and fill it up see, and walk out the door.
I see the guy carrying a trash can.
I brought in a couple of milk jugs, and I filled them up.
That's horrible.
And I walked out the
people
door.
Horrible.
And the lady's looking at me, and I said, is this free? Yes,
diabetic.
It's free. Diabetic. You know, you talk about diabetic coma.
I saw
coma.
A picture on Facebook. A guy brought in a trash can.
I know.
And a straw.
That's a dangling carrot. And I see it. I fall for it, too. I know what's going on here.
A trash can and a straw. Come on.
That's exactly right. but you have to be able to carry it out the door yourself. And you got two people, one in one arm and one in the other handle, dragging it out the door.
Why don't you just take the damn machine?
Honestly, just come in and get you a soda and walk out. Not 2 1-gallon jugs of milk.
But you're the one that did it.
I know I did it, but I'm just trying to prove a point about the dangling carrot theory.
Did you drink any of it, or did you just take it?
I went home, and it was the beginning of summer, and I put them both in my freezer. Let me tell you, slushies are excellent in the freezer. You just get one out, make a half a cup or so, and then put it back, and you have that nutritional sugar wash every time you do it. It took all summer to drink it.
I can tell you're a bachelor. Yeah, you know, you tend to do things you can totally get away with.
It took me all year to all summer to drink it, but I did it, and I offered some for friends and stuff. I was, you know, not that. Damn Curtis, he had his own milk jug, too. He was right behind me.
You seem to do things you can totally get away with.
I look for that dangling carrot. Let me give you an example. Today, I went over to 7-Eleven because I keep seeing this app on my phone that says gas at 7-Eleven is $1.60 a gallon. So I walked up to 7-Eleven. Before I got in there, I noticed there were no cars going around the block. I thought, this can't be right. So I went in to show the manager that you're at $2.25 now, and this is $1.60. She looked down at it, and as soon as she looked at it, it went off my phone. And she said, where is it? And I said, it was here a minute ago. She says, I'm not doubting you, but you know what? You have to show me. And I thought, well, she got a laser beam eyes where she can turn it off. But the last time I tried this, it was $1.50, and I had to hurry to get to 7-Eleven before the app went off my phone. As soon as I parked into the pump, I ran in the door and it went off.
I think somehow they got it set up to where you, as soon as you walk in the door, it takes it off your phone. That's what I think.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow that app probably.
The manager looked at it and she said something.
If that happened to me, I would turn around and say, well, it isn't here. I'm going to the next gas station and I would
leave. Well, then the next gas station,
first,
I'd never make it because the app would be gone.
But first, I would get my free slushie.
Yeah, my free. I keep a gallon jug in my car.
I would sit there and complain as I'm walking out with a slushie in my hand. Mm-hmm. You know, you people, you're horrible.
I still think somehow
I'm never going to shop here again.
That's a carrot that keeps me getting up at 7 o'clock to run down to 7-Eleven. Of course, I'll buy a few things on the way out the door, thinking, well, I didn't get it. But something ain't quite right with that. But my theory, again, is the dangling carrot. Follow the dangling carrot. And I'm seriously thinking that there's a whole generation of young people suckering into these credit cards. And they're getting themselves in debt at 19, 20 years old because it's so easy to slide that card and walk out the door. And man, oh man, debt. My goodness.
I know. It's terrible.
But there's follow the dangling carrots. When I was growing up, there weren't any dangling carrots.
You got to take what you can get.
Exactly.
No dangling carrots.
And I'll go over that again a little later about the dangling and carrots nothing, I've been seeing lately.
Nothing dangling but the, you know, the... I would, you know, women walking around with no bras.
Yeah. All those dangling participles. Darn dangling participles and pregnant pauses. And
here we go with that fine line again.
I brought that fine line. I got a chance today. I'll talk to you about the worst place I think I've ever been in this city. And I've noticed it. I've been there a million times to this one place. And now I finally, my eyes were open. This place is full of idiots. And I won't.
Is it where I used to work?
No, it's not where you work. It'll surprise you the next time you go there. And I can't say anything about the place, but.
Nothing shocks us anymore.
Whose band is this anyway? I'll punch you in the mouth.
We're live with the Ghostgetter.
Okay, whoops. Forgot to turn down this mic while the music was playing. Oh well, nobody's listening. You know, everybody's talking about the world's gonna end, the world's gonna end. Everybody wants to talk about the world ending. And then I get in and do a show. Let's talk about the world ending. Nah, I got something to do.
Nah, I gotta go get a slushie.
I'm gonna dangle my carrot.
Thanks for listening to the show tonight. TheNightbreedShow.wix.com/ghostgetter. JackalopeRadio.com, talking, I don't even know what I'm talking about anymore. Conspiracy Agenda theories. 21. Eugenics. Since we're all getting into the eugenics idea. Hey, Andrea, how's it going? In Facebook also, by the way. Since we're getting into the eugenics idea, he was talking about George Bernard Shaw and how he, and I didn't know this guy was this bad, but and the eugenics idea of getting rid of a certain controlled population of people. And pieces of clips of George Bernard Shaw in his own words. Which one would you want? Justify your existence? That's 40 sure. seconds.
Sure.
I don't know if that...
You must all know half a dozen people at least who are no use in this world, who are more trouble than they are worth. Just put them there and say, sir or madam, now will you be kind enough to justify your existence? If you can't justify your existence, if you're not pulling your weight in the social vote, if you're not producing as much as you consume, or perhaps a little more, then clearly we cannot use the big organization of our society for the purpose of keeping you alive, because your life does not benefit us, and it can't be of very much use to yourself.
Here's one. This is Margaret Sanger, the great woman that, you know, that Hillary Clinton, which I got into an argument with a guy about this woman, Margaret Sanger. I said, there's proof. I got proof of her talk. It's just pictures. I said, yeah. I have her talking.
Yeah.
That could be doctored. It's an interview on CBS back in the day. It just kept making up excuses for her idiot.
Many people don't really know what eugenics is. Eugenics is defined as belief in the possibility of improving the qualities of the human species by discouraging reproduction by persons having genetic defects or presumed to have inheritable, undesirable traits. Essentially, eugenics is the creation of a master race by controlling who has children and who doesn't. An article appearing in the January 31st, 1922 edition of the New York Times bore the headline, Mrs. Sanger says Superman is the aim of birth control. If creating a race of supermen is the goal, who did Sanger believe had genetic defects or undesirable traits that stood in the way?
In 1922, Sanger wrote a book entitled The Pivot of Civilization. In it is a chapter called The Cruelty of Charity, where she blasts programs that provide medical and nursing facilities to slum mothers as insidiously injurious. In the same book, Sanger called for the cessation of charity, for the segregation of morons, misfits, and the maladjusted, and for the sterilization of genetically inferior races.
These were her magazines.
She also argued that organized attempts to help the poor was the surest sign that our civilization has bred, is breeding, and is perpetuating defectives, delinquents, and dependents. The Birth Control Review was Sanger's official publication for the American Birth Control League, and in 1932 she outlined her plan for peace.
The main objectives of the Population Congress would be... to apply a stern and rigid policy of sterilization and segregation
to
that grade
of
population
whose slipped out of Hillary's mouth
is already tainted, to give certain dysgenic groups in our population their choice of segregation or sterilization, and to apportion farmlands and homesteads for these segregated persons where they would be taught to work under competent instructors for the period of their entire lives.
Sanger's admiration for the eugenics programs of Nazi Germany were well known at the time. In 1933, the Birth Control Review published Eugenic Sterilization, An Urgent Need, by Ernst Rudin, who was Hitler's director of genetic sterilization and the founder of the Nazi Society for Racial Hygiene.
Oh, and by the way, something I'm going to bring up real quick. Did you know Hitler had a book of Blavatsky and on his bedside at night? And every night he would read and follow her belief system. And Blavatsky is also, Margaret Sanger was one of her students. So, yeah.
In her praise for the eugenics programs in Germany, Sanger called for the implementation of such programs in the United States, specifically targeting African Americans.
Yeah.
The following editorial was published in the 1932 issue of the Birth Control Review.
The Negro problem is one of the most complicated and important confronting America. Whatever the ultimate answer may be, such an attitude brings to light the necessary agency in its solution. The present submerged condition of the Negro is due in large part to the high fertility of the race under disastrously adverse circumstances. Thus, the question arises, to what extent birth control has had a eugenic effect upon the Negro?
Okay, now, here's something. This is coming out of her own two lips. These are Sanger's words, okay? This is an interview that she did when asked about a greatest sin. What do you believe your greatest sin is? This is great. She's an honest person.
What are your religious beliefs, Mrs. Sanger? Do you believe in a God in the sense of a divine being who rewards or punishes people after death?
Well, I have a different attitude about the divine. I feel that we have divinity within us. And the more we express the good part of our lives, the more the divine within us expresses itself.
That's what Blavatsky taught.
I suppose I would call myself an Episcopalian by religion. And there's many other, if you've traveled around the world, you get quite a bit of the feeling of all religions have so much alike in the divine part of our own being. And I suppose you just couldn't put that in a book, or you couldn't put it into a phrase or a sentence.
Do you believe in sin? When I say believe, I don't mean believe in committing sin. Do you believe there is such a thing as sin?
Well, I think the greatest sin in the world is bringing children into the world that have disease from their parents, that have no chance in the world to be a human being, practically. Delinquents, prisoners, all sorts of things, just marked when they're born.
Marked when they're born.
She's talking about black children.
People can commit.
But sin in the ordinary sense that we regard it, do you
marked
believe
when
or
they're
do
you born.
Not?
Well, what would they be?
Do you believe that infidelity is a sin?
Well, I'm not going to specify what I think is sin. I've stated what I think is worse sin.
Yes, but then you asked me to say what, and I said what, and you refused to answer me?
Yes, I don't know about infidelity. Yeah. It has so many personalities to it, and what person's own belief is. I couldn't generalize any of those things as being sin.
Murder is a sin.
Well, I naturally think murder is a, whether it's a sin or not, it's a terrible act.
She doesn't really have a remorseful word in her body when she's... Terrible.
Murder's an act.
Murder is terrible.
It could be a terrible thing, depending on who you are. Here's a great one.
Mrs. Margaret Slee, president of America's Planned Parenthood Federation, maintains that European women should stop having babies for the next 10 years.
Don't you think such a theory, such a radical theory, is antisocial?
On the contrary, it seems to me that it is more practical and humane.
What about the women who want babies now and in 10 years will not be able to have babies? Rather impractical, don't you think?
Oh, John, you do ask hard questions. I should think that instead of being impractical, it is really very practical and intelligent and humane.
But Mrs. Slee, in this country, having babies is the only thing left which is both unrationed and untaxed. Do you think we really ought to stop?
Well, I suppose a subject like that is really so personal that it's entirely up to the parents to decide. But from my view, I believe that there should be no more babies in starving countries for the next 10 years.
Especially in Africa, right?
You could always eat them.
And what's she considered starving country?
Africa.
Uh-huh.
And what color
are they? Well, that's virtually every country in Africa.
The black people are.
Yeah, of course. You know. And here, you're going to love this one. This is Hillary Clinton on Sanger. Yeah, this is... This is great. This is Hillary Clinton.
Let me say, with respect to your comments about Margaret Sanger.
It's her hypocrisy.
You know, I admire Thomas Jefferson. I admire his words and his leadership, and I deplore his unrepentant slaveholding. I admire Margaret Sanger being a pioneer in trying to empower women to have some control over their bodies, and I deplore statements that you have referenced. Is the way we often are when we look at flawed human beings. There are things that we admire and things we deplore.
And I'm like, okay, that's fine.
I thought it was kind of interesting how she spoke of flawed human beings.
Right.
Just
but
like
here she is accepting award at the Planned Parenthood Association.
She said the words deplorable twice.
Well, thank you.
Hypocrisy right here.
So much. It's great to be back in Houston with so many friends and to have an opportunity to participate in the Planned Parenthood annual meeting. I have to tell you that it was a great privilege when I was told that I would receive this award. I admire Margaret Sanger enormously.
Uh-huh.
Her courage, her
She's
tenacity.
Not deplorable or anything.
She said the word.
Her vision.
Yeah, her vision.
Another of my great friends, Alan Chesler, is here, who wrote a magnificent biography of Margaret Sanger called Woman of Valor.
Oh, yeah.
And when I think about what she did all those years ago in Brooklyn, taking on archetypes, taking on attitudes and accusations flowing from all directions, I am really in awe of her. And there are a lot of lessons that we can learn from her life and from the cause she launched and fought for and sacrificed so greatly.
Doesn't sound very flawed to me, does it? Especially when you're receiving an award from Planned Parenthood.
Yeah.
You know, this is why I'm glad the woman didn't win, because she would have made sure that they got the funding they needed to kill more people.
Yeah.
Yeah. And well, this is the agenda that they're trying to continue in this country.
I think she slipped up when she said the word deplorable, you know, during the election, because that pretty much told what was in her heart, thinking of the black people and such. That was just wrong.
It's ridiculous.
Well, for someone who was running for public office of any degree, whether it be dog catcher or president, to speak of a certain amount or a particular part of society as being beneath you and deplorables, then or flawed individuals or whatever nasty words they want to use, you know, it astonishes me.
Who was that multi-billionaire woman who owned an entire building?
Oprah. What?
No, and she
the Walmart.
She called the little people. She mentioned the word the little people. She was about as rich as Trump was. I can't remember who she was, but she called us the little people, and I mean.
Let them eat cake?
Yeah. I think so.
Bernard Shaw appealed to the chemist to discover a humane gas that will kill instantly and painlessly. Humane gas that will kill people. Yeah. Well, let's not make him go through any kind of pain.
No, let's not do that.
You know, it's humane killing.
Well, let's go back again to the controlling of the populations. That people are, you know, always trying to control the population of the world and the people. And I saw them trying to do that in Mesquite, too. And I think they put a stop to it after like 20 years, where the realtors were allowed to sell homes in Mesquite, but Mesquite had a rule that you could only put certain black people in this neighborhood, certain Hispanic in this, and certain of that in this. And they had it well under control. And I was shocked to find out they had rules for this and they were doing this. I found this out because the lady who sold us our first and second home brought this to light, that a lot of people didn't realize that Mesquite was controlling the number of ethnicities in each neighborhood. Well, they let that go.
Well, Lubbock does that.
Well, I don't think it's right, because I think if a black person wants to be in
a
neighborhood,
you know,
that's all
bring
that
his
is.
Friends and
Lubbock
all
has
that
problem.
Fine.
Lubbock has a huge segregation problem.
Yeah. Well, you look at all these people that got moved around when they lost their homes during the crisis, the mortgage crisis, I guess. I don't know. They just tried to get a number of people in these picture homes pretty cheap. Then they pulled the rug out from under them.
Somebody put in there, if we killed all the idiots, there would only be a few hundred of us left.
There'd be a few morons left. I mean, that's okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
But
I just love it, though, how they use these intelligent words from their brain to make themselves sound as if they're trying to manipulate you into voting on what they want you to say.
Well, they appear to be smarter than we are.
Define a minority for somebody after.
Yes, minority is based on the federal definition, really based on the ethnicity. So, any non-white
is minority.
That's not the definition.
Yeah. This woman's calling her on it. She was an Asian lady.
By the federal definition, yes.
I just want to understand what you're saying.
Yes, absolutely. But as a matter of fact, we do see, that's a great question, Tracy, we do see a trend that so defined a minority may become majority in terms of the population.
So if there's less Caucasian people, then are they the minorities too, or not?
Caucasians are still considered as non-minority by definition.
When we live in Montana, Hispanic people are the majority.
In numbers.
But that's not what you would consider a minority. So you consider there's less Caucasian people, that's not a minority. Okay.
Hispanics, even in your community, they are majority by number. They are still defined as minority.
What are we playing?
That's ridiculous.
Yeah. She's trying to say, this is a woman trying to develop a transportation, billion-dollar transportation. I think it was like a people train. I'm thinking, what's this got to do with a minority population? And she's trying to say that there's a minority population, but whites are not a minority.
Well, she's twisting the definition of minority right. and majority. A minority population is a population that is low in numbers. Say if you got 20 blacks... And you've got, that would be a minority if you have 80 whites. They're the smaller group. They're right. not, has nothing to do with the money you make or whatever. Now, I was in a school.
But whites are not a minority.
Last 2 years that I taught, the whites were the minority in the elementary school. We had, I think, like 80 whites and the rest were Hispanic and black. So the whites were a minority. The majority were the black students. That's the most. Has nothing to do with income. It's the amount
right,
of
it's
the population.
Just numbers. It's
she
all
she wasn't
numbers.
Trying to do that. She
no,
was
she's
saying
just
whites
trying to
could
push,
never be a minority.
And she automatically tags white people as with white privilege. You know, a white person walks into a room full of Hispanics, and they're still the majority.
Nah,
that person's still the majority in her definition.
Any idea? She has no idea what that is. And the lady that's asking
she does.
Her
she's just trying to manipulate
is more intelligent
people
than she is, and she just can't give her the right answer.
She's trying. I don't think she's stupid. I think she's trying to manipulate
it's
people.
An agenda.
Into, yeah.
Yeah.
It's a part of it. But you yeah. see all kinds of people sneaking in cameras in these places that are in yeah. these city leaders and stuff like that trying to implement these.
Well, I think another thing, too, and I think our president's finding this out, too, now that he's got come down off the top of the castle, is that as we as a population begin to grow and technology grows, that statistics and things of the past are finally coming up where you had to put it on pencil and paper. But now statistically, you can do history over again and find out that, did you say that majority of abortions
are
certain population? Well, now that's a statistic, a truth statistic. You can't lie about statistics. And people are trying to dodge the bullet and run around this and that, but statistics are going to catch them. And, you know, you can do all the abortion you want, but statistically, your race is the one that's having all the abortions.
Right.
You can't argue with that, but it's just the way it is. And
well, you know, this makes perfect sense, though, why they're trying to open these Planned Parenthood buildings in the poorer neighborhoods. You don't see them all in Highland Park and places like that. It's not like people don't get pregnant if they're rich or have money in a better neighborhoods. They won't have sex.
Yeah.
Or they won't get pregnant and they're not married.
Yeah.
You know, so it doesn't make any sense. Well, only the people that are poor, and they use the excuse because they have nothing better to do. Yeah. So, so you mean to tell me that, you know, once you get past that and you start making money, you just give up that?
If Planned Parenthood wants to really get something done, poor or rich neighborhoods, they need to find a way to make the guy who's got his six girlfriends pregnant, find a way to get him to pay for it or come up with some idea.
Get him neutered.
Well, I wouldn't say neutered because we're trying not to do that.
Castrate.
But there's just too many, and I say guys, there's too many guys out there that are just humping everything that they can probably,
you know.
I can't say it on the radio.
I read, I saw.
They need to be held accountable for what they did.
I saw China's rules for one child per parent.
Yeah.
And they said you have to have a license to be married. You have to get a license before you get married. You got to go through all this paperwork to get registered, to get licensed, to get married. And once you get married, to have a kid, you have to have a license to have a child that has to be approved by the government to get that license. Once you get that license and go through all this paperwork, then the government has control, almost like ownership of this child. So I'm thinking, good grief.
How many people are going to follow that?
And China,
they're going to go behind the bushes.
Yeah,
under
but
the bed
if you have,
that, well,
according to China, these Chinese law though, if you have a child out of wedlock or without license or paperwork or whatever, then it's illegal.
Yeah,
that
what
children,
do they do for
that
you?
Child is illegal.
Take so, that child from you.
Yeah,
and put it in Penthurst.
Probably send it to the United States as immigration.
But they've got to do something about the people see, that...
Jolie, what's her name, probably come and pick it up.
No, got to do something about the people that are going around, whites, black, Hispanic, it doesn't matter who they are, who've got five, six kids, seven kids, and it's one guy and seven different women. And
It's usually the other way, Jeff. It's one woman and five or six different
I've
guys.
I've seen that on Judge Judy. You don't watch enough Judge Judy. You don't watch enough Judge Judy.
I watch it.
Because I've seen women. I've seen enough women on there that have five daddies.
Yeah, well, one today had 11. She looked at Judge Judy, and Judge Judy, you know what Judge Judy was thinking. How in the world can you afford that? But she said she can handle it.
Oh, man.
But I remember there was a situation going on in the apartment complex that I lived in, which was a little bit of a lower income apartment because I was cheap, where this guy, there were several women in different apartment complexes who were pregnant.
Right.
And being pregnant, they were going on welfare, but food stamps.
Welfare.
The guy would come by once a month.
I guess that's for every child you have, you got five kids.
Whoa. This guy was coming by every month, picking up his welfare cards from all these women. He was making a fortune off of it. You know, you talk about a lot of money, and
what
I.
What did they call that woman?
They call it a welfare pimp.
Who did they call that woman during the 80s that was busted by Reagan, who was going from state to state picking up welfare checks under assumed names?
Well, this is a lot easier.
They called her welfare something.
Welfare Annie.
Yeah, she had a
Well, this guy had a gig going. I mean, he was going from
of course he was.
Apartment to apartment. He was taking the cards and making money and leaving her a little bit. And, of course, she had to raise the child.
Yeah, of course.
But, you know, that's not the only apartment complex this guy was going to. He was going to others, too. And easy money. Every month, easy money. He'd take that food stamps.
Does he have a YouTube channel?
No, he'd take those food stamps and he'd sell them under budget. Under
have a YouTube channel. I'll teach you five ways to
that's how you make your money. But every month I would hear the door slam and he would go from door to door to door. And then one of the women would come out and scream and holler, "You didn't leave me enough money." And
they have those conferences in North Dallas, you know, how to make more money.
How to make more money.
It's $100 per plate.
Man,
here's the last undercover meeting. This is a city meeting. These are city leaders, by the way.
My name is Warren Whitlock. I am the the Associate Administrator for Civil Rights for the Federal Highway Administration. I'm going to detail for the next few months with the Secretary.
How is it
a
Civil Rights Highway Administration?
Throughout the 11 regions of the country. Secretary Fox issued a draft study earlier this year called Beyond Traffic, a framework for the next 30 years of what the different transportation implications are going
to
be.
Transportation is literally the road to our future. As part of a larger mega region, Long Beach is attracting non-driving millennials, and you probably saw them coming in, and immigrants who make up a great use of our light rail and our growing bicycle infrastructure.
First of all, it's great to be in Long Beach, California, in the Southern California mega region.
Mega region. What they're calling them now.
Really should be.
11 mega regions around the country.
Fit into our options that we provide customers in the future for getting around Southern California and the other mega cities here in the United States.
Mega cities.
Now, as Chip said, this is the third of our 11 mega region orgs. And so we started off in Sacramento, we went to Phoenix, and now we're here in Southern California. Now, in our research, we identified 11 different mega regions throughout the country. What we have determined a mega region is a center of economic, social, and infrastructure ties throughout the country. So one of the things you want to look at with this particular mega region is that you're projected to almost a 62% growth rate by 2050. That's a lot more people.
That's how we arrive at the 16,196 residential units that are currently being proposed.
The short answer to your question is we're growing as a city. SCAG is projecting that this city will add about 20,000 people in the next 20 years.
That's what they're doing, basically. They're pulling people from the outer rim, and they're, you know, kind of like cleaning the toilet bowl.
Yeah.
Might as well get them from the outer rim. And
yeah. Well, they've been doing that for a while because, you know, it's easier to control the masses when you have them in central locations.
When they can't afford to live anywhere.
Yeah, well, when you provide government assistance and government everything.
That's what Section 8
has. I like how they talk
public transportation
about millennials, how to fix their... So they don't have to drive an hour to get to work. They can live right next to their work downtown. They don't have to drive and spend money on gas and carbon munitions and ruin the environment. You know, they can ride bikes. So we can build bike paths and trains that, you know, have smog and ruin the environment.
Well, that's the ponies and daffodil stories,
yeah,
they'll give you. But
they do.
But it basically boils down to it's easier to control the masses when they're in a central location. This is why the American farmers are under attack. The family farms are under attack. You know, they get regulated out of existence, and now you end up having corporate own farms and all that, so all that stuff. These people have to sell off their farms and move to town, where it's easier to, you know, it's been an attack on rural America for a while now.
That's why the guy, what was it, over the beginning of the winter fall, that huge complaint. I mean, huge story about the guy. The people wouldn't give up their farmland, and he wound up getting killed. I believe the guy that was had a standoff because they were trying to take his land. I think it was in Utah or somewhere like that.
Well, the people have been having brushes with the BLM for a while now, the Bureau of Land Management.
Yeah.
Because they're going around taking up huge, or they have been taking up huge swaths of land and making it illegal to do anything on it. And again, which it's harmful to the ranchers, it's harmful to the farmers. And it's just another way to try to control others and force them into the cities.
Huh. Strange. I guess what we're going to do is take a break real quick and come back. We're going to talk about the our random, what do you call it, free-for-all, your grievance. Yeah. Yeah, your grievance, your complaints.
Why not?
I'm not listening.
Hey, you! Shut your blowhole.
We're back with the Ghost Getter.
TheNightbreedShow.wix.com/Ghost Getter. Find us on YouTube, the recorded show on YouTube, YouTube.com/Ghost Getter. Give us a like on YouTube and Patreon as well, Patreon.com/Ghost Getter. And you can find us on Facebook and everywhere else. So that's where we be. It's free for all time. This can get ugly. Everybody has their own grievance. This can get very ugly. We've already heard Jeff earlier about 7-Eleven, so...
I'm not done.
I think you've already gave your time up.
Okay, David, your time.
No, I'm just kidding. I don't care. So he
what do you have?
He doesn't have
about?
A grievance. He has to think about it for
He's
an
so
hour.
Easy going.
I don't have grievances.
He doesn't get answers on his text.
Have a microphone. Hang on.
That's my grievance. You pounded on that microphone.
Yeah. There you go. I just found one. It's your stupid mic pounding.
What a
well,
grievance!
I've got another one. If you want me to take my turn.
What's your grievance?
Mic in my ear. That's what it is.
Oh, okay.
Well, let
That's
me.
A pet peeve.
Let me tell you. This one was today.
Oh, great.
You know how you go to the same place all the time and you get out and you go into the store. You don't realize that this things are going on around you that you just take it for granted. But my eyes, the scales dropped from my eyes today. And I actually drove around in the parking lot to see if what I was seeing was true. It is. I can't mention the store, can I?
It don't matter.
Okay, it's Home Depot.
Yeah. Okay.
In Mesquite. All right.
You've already said 7-Eleven, so well, why are you discriminating against Home Depot?
I went in there and I pulled my
say where it is.
I pulled my car in. Of course, for one thing, all these people are supposed to be at work, and I'm retired, so it kind of irks me all these people walking around. They don't work. Anyway, I pulled my car into this parking space, and I couldn't get all the way in because this Mastodonus-looking truck was taking the parking space he was in and a quarter of mine. So I had to back out to go to another parking space. And I went to another one, but I couldn't get in there because this guy was over the line. So I looked over here. I bet you 70% of that people in that parking lot couldn't park in the line, in their line. So where are you going to find a parking space? So I ended up on the way far end of the parking lot to walk in. Okay, I'm getting to the point here about everyone in here is an idiot.
He looked like he's about seconds away from taking my monitor and throwing it out the window.
I'm about to kick something here in a minute. I thought, okay, here we got all these people who are carpenters, who design your home, pour your concrete, draw the lines on your roof to make sure your tiles are straight, can't park in a line at Home Depot. In between the lines with their trucks. They're all over the damn place like they're in a soccer match or something and running in because they're missing a soccer match. I won't say the ethnicity. Anyway, I went in there. I thought, okay, let me go in this door that opens up automatically as a courtesy. And
yeah,
I almost get hit
a lot of Asians
in
that,
the head.
That, you know,
almost
play
get hit in the head from some guy who's coming out the entranceway. Because he's got a board sticking out of the wrong cart. Thought that, okay, cheater. Supposed to go out the in, not in the out. Anyway, I'm going in there and I'm walking around and the lines are everywhere. People are walking all over. No common courtesy at all. Excuse me. I'm going around people and all that stuff is on the floor. And I can't find a stupid valve for my hose. On the outside of my house, okay? So I'm walking around, and I'm just completely surrounded by idiots. And I'm thinking, why in the world I even come in here? I come in here 1,000 times. I didn't realize this. And I go to the back to look for a hose thing, and there's nobody there in the garden section. And I need to find this clamp for my hose. Nobody. I'll bet you if I picked something up and put it in my pocket, there'd be 30 people there to arrest me. But I can't find anybody in there, so I got to find this stupid thing myself. Well, I finally found it, but I had to lean over the top of all this junk they had against the shelves so I can get it. What's all this junk doing here? You know, where's the common courtesy in people that are trying to reach for stuff on shelves? I had to practically push it all out of the way. So I go over there, and I finally said, I've had enough of this. I'm ready
day.
To... I'm ready to get out of here. I feel like I'm being consumed by the idiocy fog. So anyway, I get up to the counter and I'm ready to check out, and there's a lady ahead of me. And I'm just standing there, and this lady behind me puts her stuff on the little belt there ahead of me. And I look behind me, and she's like, do you not see? I didn't say it, but I thought, you know, do you not see me standing here that you just did that? Am I invisible? Are you the one that's parked on two lines? But she just went on through, and she walked out the door. And I asked the lady who was doing the checkout, did you not see that she cut in front of me? She said, I saw that. The lady behind me saw that, and the lady behind her saw that. And I just, I thought, you know what? I should have just, but I didn't. I didn't say anything or nothing. I just walked out.
I'm never
going to
quit my job. This is what happens when you retire.
This exact, and I went outside and.
Kat said, lesson, do not shop with Jeff.
I know. I went outside to my car and I thought, man, I'm glad I'm finally out of this. I'm going to get in my car and leave. And then I can't find my damn car. And my first thought is, somebody stole my car.
That's what happens when you're retired.
In this idiot Home Depot parking lot. Of course, I'm accusing somebody. And I have to keep pushing my button to find my car when it beeps. The alarm beeps. And it was like 30 miles away. I forgot I had to park at the
far end. Do you realize that you are your mother now?
I know. I had to park at the far end.
You've become your mother.
Of the parking lot so I can get out of there.
He parked it across the highway and forgot.
And I'll tell you what. I kind of feel bad that the scales dropped from my eyes at this place because I like this place. But now every time I go there, I'm going to be thinking, man. There's nothing but idiots here at all. And I swear 70% of all the parking was people who couldn't park in a space that were on the lines. And again, I'm thinking these are supposed to be our carpenters and our people that are going to, you know, help us out to build the wall down in
in southern Mexico or southern Texas.
Yeah. Southern Texas.
Yeah. Is it Home Depot? People
anyway,
Home Depot?
I hate Home Depot now. I will probably go to Lowe's for the rest of my life. That's a little more uppity anyway.
I got a little trick for you, though. I've seen somewhere where what you can do, these people that are bad parkers,
yeah,
that, you know, they just, they're asking for it.
Yeah.
You know, you carry around zip ties in your car.
There you go. Yeah.
There you go. And then what you do is you get a buggy and you put it right up against their door handle and zip tie the buggy to their door handle. That'll teach them right there. They're either going to pull their door handle off their
good
own
idea.
Car or they're going to spend 10 minutes trying to figure out how they're going to get it off the
now,
car.
Now, let me be positive about something. Let me throw a positive in here. I don't want people to think I'm an idiot. Sometimes I go to Aldi. I love Aldi and Mesquite. And I usually go when there's not very many cars there because I can't park either. There will be shopping carts all over the parking lot.
You don't have to worry about a quarter.
And there's a quarter in each one of those carts. So I thought, well, hell, I'll just go ahead and get me a bunch of carts and roll them up to the door and just start getting me some quarters. I figured these people are too lazy.
I saw that movie with Tom Hanks. Do you remember seeing that movie?
Got no,
the Terminal.
To do,
that's
Desi.
What it was, The Terminal.
Well, you know, the one time I actually spent an hour and a half collecting about 20 carts. That were out in the parking lot because people are too lazy to push the cart all the way back up and get a quarter.
Probably waiting on
okay,
you.
First off, I'm going to call BS on that story because this is Mesquite.
Yeah.
A. B, this is Aldi.
Yeah.
No, nobody ever leaves their buggy because people are so cheap that they're not going to leave that quarter in the buggy.
No,
so I'm calling BS. You're
I'm
at Walmart is what it was, and you
no,
thought they had
I'm
quarters
the
in your carts at Walmart.
I'm the king of cheap. I must have made, I don't know how
That's
many quarters I put
the
in my pocket.
Quarters in it.
But if you will just take two carts and push it to the next one and push it to the next one and look like you work there, you know. I made some good money, and I'll still do it when I go in there. I'll get me some money. I figured, you know, so that's my positive. Aldi.
I guess I don't need your
that's
beef.
That's a little.
Guess we just sit here for the next half hour.
Do you have anything to complain about?
My only complaints are the same ones over and over again. People driving. People that suck. Don't know how to use their turn
Jesus.
Signal.
Oh, yeah.
That just
yeah, I like that one.
Aggravates the
crap out of me.
I remember years ago you said you never use your turn signal because...
He used to get mad at me for using it.
If you use your turn signal, it lets the person behind you know your strategy, and most times they're going
to
cut you off.
He used to get mad at me when he would like...
Have you changed on that?
No. Wait a minute.
Are you one of these people to put your turn signal on?
Okay, you are your mother, remember? You are your mother.
He used to get mad at me for using
it.
He'd get mad at me for using it. You don't have to use your turn signal after every turn, you know.
Yeah, no, I get mad if you flip on your signal and you leave it on for a quarter mile.
No.
That's what I get aggravated with.
That happened like once.
you put your turn signal on when the two wheels are already over the line and it's too late anyway.
I hate people that do that. They turn and then they turn their turn signal on.
What about the ones that get into another lane, then they put their turn signal on
to let you know.
You know, I'm over here.
I just said that.
So have you changed? Do you feel like that you do the turn signal thing?
I do the turn signal all the time.
There you go.
I even tell myself, you know what? That butthead that cut me off and didn't use the signal, I'm going to cut him off. But I'm going to use my signal when I do it, though, at least.
Okay. Well, that's good. That's fair.
But, driving, that's my biggest pet
peeve. Last week, we went to Lubbock. We were going to Lubbock. We were driving down 20. Yeah. And some guy... We were driving in the fast lane, and she was doing, I mean, the speed limit was, I think, 75. They upped it to 75, 70 or 75. But I know we were going faster than that. And some guy in some small car, Porsche-like car with no top on, you know, he almost cuts us off and nearly runs us into the wall. He gets right over, right, and gets in the fast lane, around us and nearly hits us.
Yeah.
And when Irene honked at him, he goes like that, like, get out of the fast lane.
Yeah.
Like, we're already driving over the speed limit. What more do you want? Yeah. You know?
See, that's a little bit dangerous because if you're
you shouldn't ride in the fast lane if there's nobody, because that's a passing lane.
He came out of nowhere. He wasn't even behind us.
Well, he's a little midget. He drives a midget car.
It's a midget car.
And when the first place, he came out of nowhere, and he nearly... Yeah. It doesn't give you a right to nearly run you off the road.
Yeah, I know.
And then do
that. Did he have his turn signal on?
No.
Yeah.
And then do this.
Well, you need to get into the other lane.
That just pisses me off even more.
The gay hand. The gay
girl. You're supposed to be
in the right lane. That's where I went to the point when, you didn't do that.
Oh, no, you didn't.
No. Yeah. I'm going to call the... blow on you if I ever see you again.
I must confess though, I think I've flipped off probably 35 to 40% of the Dallas people in the Dallas area so far this year.
A lot of people. That's a lot of finger.
Oh yeah.
That's a lot of birds.
I've gotten.
That makes sense. Kat said if you're retired, get a job at Walmart. You make more money pushing carts.
No, there's no quarters. I'd get a job at Aldi if I could.
Yeah, but you still make
get
more
a quarter
money
out of every one
if
of
you,
the
if you're grabbing the carts. You know, they're getting off cheaper. You can probably do it per hour, get paid more.
Yeah. Sometimes when I go past Aldi, I'll go by and look to see if carts are out there. If I see one, I'll go back.
You know, they probably do that on purpose.
So it's
going to
burn about 50 cents in gas going around the block.
No, not
coming around.
They probably
around,
do
into,
that on purpose.
Pulling into Aldi in that perfect parking space that has just the amount of room for him to where nobody's nowhere near the lines.
Well, they probably do that on purpose when he, you know, they see him coming. Oh crap, here comes our cart guy. And they throw a whole bunch of them out.
I saw that movie not that long ago again, Terminal with Tom Hanks. That's exactly what you remind me of.
Yeah.
Cheap bastard.
Speaking different.
You know, you could get a can of tuna for 50 cents. That's like a whole lunch right there. That's pretty good. Two carts, pull them in there, you can get a can of tuna. I know how to handle myself. That's right.
Wow.
I do.
Your inspiration.
That's a Section 8 part of my brain, and it still exists.
You should have your own YouTube channel. How to get cans of tuna for 50 cents.
50 cents of tuna.
One subscriber.
In water, not in oil, in water. You know,
Oh my gosh.
I have all kinds of complaints. I drive around all day long complaining about stuff.
Don't even get me started on liberals.
Is he getting to that age?
Liberals just piss me off.
I spent 30 years in that gym with kids, and I could never get out further than 100 yards from the building on a given day. And now that I know there's a real world out there filled with idiots, filled with them. And it's my responsibility to point it out every now and then, you know. So that's what I do.
I don't know. You know what makes me mad? And I can make this quick. It's Kim Jong-un, and every time he says, well, if you start anything with us, then we're going to blast you out of the air. We're going to you started a war, and we're going to send bombs. It's like every time he accuses us of starting crap, but yet they're over there starting crap. Yeah. You know, I don't understand the logic in this. People that are bullying and saying, if you start trouble, you know, if you do it one more time, if you provoke us. It's like, what have you been doing provoking us since the 1950s, you jacktard?
Well, you notice that Trump isn't warning and warning and warning. He's already given his warning. And this guy can warn all he wants, but Trump's not going to draw a line in the sand. He's just going to drop a bomb on your head. But this guy's just he must have worked in Home Depot at one point in his life. He must have.
With that hair.
I'm serious.
He looks like somebody that looked like a card pusher.
Yeah.
It's like, you know what? Just because you got that jacked up haircut doesn't mean you got the right to go around acting like an idiot in your country.
Yeah.
It's not our fault you got a bad haircut.
We used to have when we were kids. He looked like that old saying, fat boy. He's a fat boy. Look at that fat boy.
Well, it's maybe not even him. It's saying, you don't really hear him ever say anything. It's always everybody else that says everything.
Oh, he's got that cheesy cheek mouth.
You know what's really interesting is... interesting thing about it is, you've never heard him talk, and there's probably a reason for it. Because he'd probably say, if you have anything to say, well...
Yeah, he's got a squeaky voice.
He sounds like Mike Tyson.
Mike Tyson.
That could be it.
If you provoke us one more time.
It's like, who's that guy that used to play for the Chicago Bears? The Sweetness? Toughest running back would knock you
Walter
over.
Walter Payton.
Yes. Man, I'm just trying to do my part. I'm trying to do my part.
If you provoke us.
And then I got the fridge picking me up and trying to shove me over the line.
Because it would make him sound weak. It would make him sound weak if he comes up there and says, if you provoke us one more time, everybody goes,
we're going to huff and puff and blow your country down.
He sounded like Curly on the Three Stooges. Why do you provoke me?
And everybody looks and goes, what the hell?
What the hell? Is that what we're supposed to be afraid of? Man, here's a missile for you. Let's shove it up your wing chang. Man, oh, man. That's probably it. Somebody whispered in his ear, sir, it's probably not right. Or not a good thing if you want to raise your voice, you know, because you might lose about 80% of your people.
Yeah.
Now, Hitler, he was...
I just saw, like, a video about a week ago of Mussolini talking, and it's just weird how he does it, you know. After he speaks, he stops and he goes, like that.
That's when you're supposed to clap.
He puts his arms across, and he looks up in the air like,
oh, like I that. Thought you were talking about Barack Obama.
Well, that too, but
yeah, that too. You see, that's how he controlled the masses. That's how you control the masses.
Margaret Sanger.
You just cross your arms and look up in the air. You know, oh, that's when we're supposed to goose step. No, that's when you're supposed to clap.
It sounds like Omer.
You should give him a voice on Facebook. Get his picture in there. Let's put a whole bunch of voices on there. And try to see which one, have a contest, which one sounds better like him. I like Curly and the Three Stooges. That would be kind of cool.
Yeah, that would work.
Yeah, that would work. Yeah, it's interesting.
Oh, man, that would be horrible. I can't
we should send
imagine.
Him a letter or something. You know, his poor dad is dying of foot rot, so we can't be
his dad's
too
already
hard
dead.
On. Did he already die?
Yeah.
That's right, he died.
Yeah, why do you think he took over?
Diabetes.
He died.
Too many Snickers. Snicker bars.
More or less.
Yeah.
How disgusting is that, you know?
Yeah.
To be, you know, all these generations of tough dictators and come down to
squeaky.
Squeaky.
You know what we should do? We should do another. I'll drive around this week like always. Well, I've got to be here most of the time. I'll drive around next week and I'll look for some things that maybe to draw out people's attention of things that go on here in Mesquite that maybe need to be fixed or complained about. They deserve to be complained about. So,
yeah, you know.
I'll think of some things.
You just feel like when he stands up there and starts speaking, it's more, you hear this.
Exactly. That's perfect. That's perfect. Something like Ted Nugent would do when, at a concert or something.
Yeah.
What a bunch of dumbasses.
That's Yeah, we need some Stooge music, some Stooges. Yeah. Put a little Curly in there. Quiet, dummy.
Yeah. I don't know how that would work, but yeah, you'd have to if you could find a video of him actually speaking, that's the problem.
Doesn't matter. We don't want to hear
it. I have another complaint too. I'm thinking about getting rid of HBO. If it wasn't for that one show, I'd already gotten rid of it because they're so liberal now. It's irritating.
Yeah.
You know, I saw a thing, Vice, which is a show on HBO, but I saw it on my computer today where they were talking about, the celebration they had in North Korea with Kim Jong-un and all this stuff.
Yeah.
This comes after their failed launch and how they're having a celebration, what they could and couldn't say being there. And there's only a certain amount of reporters that could show up. And it really gets me is all this stuff of what's going on. And then she says the reason the launch failed was the United States' fault for sabotaging their missiles. I'm like, you would blame the United States for something like that.
I think they did.
Well, I'm like, you know, you're so liberal. You blame the United States for something that, you know, the murderous dictatorship, and you're choosing their side. I'm so sick and tired of
all they did was scramble the crap. They scrambled the 1970 sound thing they used to launch the missiles.
Now, see, I don't agree with that. I don't think there's any way in the world they were able to hack their computers.
Oh, my gosh.
That, you know, because they still use computers with tubes and everything like that. So you can't hack a computer with tubes.
I saw a thing
today. You have to crank them up and warm it up.
These Koreans were putting this launcher in a rocket launcher that you put on the ground. And it said, this is the failed rocket launch in North Korea. And the guy put it in the tube and it came out about 1 foot and fell on the ground. And all the guys started taking off running because they launched it. It just fell on the ground.
I saw that.
Did you?
I saw that.
The failed launch in North Korea.
Looked like a kid's toy.
Only the United States could put something like that up and get away with it. Oh my gosh, that was funny.
Looked like a child's toy.
I think it was real because these were Korean soldiers. But I believe, I honestly believe they sabotaged that missile by
using
frequency because they can hack into that stuff. The United States is not stupid. Well,
I don't know about that.
That's a little warning to everyone else around the world that feels like they want to do some rocket stuff.
Mm-hmm.
We have the capability of knocking it out before it gets up too high. I really believe that.
Well, I think there's a lot of cyber wars going on all over the world right now. Anyway, you know, that seems to be the newest warfare everybody's engaging in.
Yeah.
But
it's technology.
At what point do you stop with the computers and go to more of a physical war because of a cyber attack or something like that?
You do that when the nation you're fighting throws rocks at you. Because...
Yeah, well...
Isn't that what Einstein said once? I don't know how World War IV would start, but I know it would be with rocks or something like that.
Wouldn't be surprised.
Yeah. North Korea, they really scare me. Yeah, they scare me.
Now, there's going to be some trouble in North Korea. I see it coming.
Well, China's supposed to be stepping in, taking care of it.
Well, they've put troops on the border and everything like that, so they've actually stepped up their
I heard North Korea did too.
With what?
I just heard earlier North Korea was evacuating people and moving troops around and...
They're expecting an attack, which I don't know that this country would do a preeminent strike of any kind.
They have to have Senate approval to do that, though, right?
70% of their economy.
Or is it like China. Up to 90 days?
Well, to declare war, I don't know. I know you have certain things you have to run by Congress, but you don't...
I think he can do it within 90 days without Congress approval.
There's a lot of gray areas, just like the missile attack in Syria and everything like that.
I think China will step in, take care of it.
Well, we're hoping so.
That's what the case is. I'm thinking that he's yapping. The only reason he yaps his big mouth is because he has China behind him. He's like he's like that guy that, yeah, what he said when the other guy's standing there.
Yeah. Do what he says.
Like that new Carl's Jr. commercial.
Well, the thing is,
shut up, Jr.
he was that way for a long time, but now China realizes, you know, with Trump in office, that, you know, they're not going to be allowed, going to be able to let him, they're going to have to reel him in. In other words, they're not going to let him run around. The street lights are on. It's time to come back home.
Yeah. Well, I like the way Trump said, you know, since 70% of their income goes into North Korea, that, hey, they're trading. It's just, come on, trade with us. We'll take care of you. You know,
their failed launch.
It's like a thing that came out of the tube.
But you know, one thing that aggravates the heck out of me is this.
Your grains, McGee's.
You know, I'm not a huge Trump supporter at all. You know, I didn't. I didn't want him to win. I was a Ted Cruz supporter, but you know, when it came down to it, it was either Donald Trump or the second coming of Margaret Sanger.
Yeah.
I had to vote for Trump. No, it just, I felt like I had
well,
no,
you know,
choice.
I didn't want her in office because she's a warmonger. And yet, what is he doing?
Yeah. No, I don't worry about her being a warmonger. I worry about her, her deep, far left agenda.
Yeah.
That, you know, I mean, deep progressive agenda.
Well, he used to be a Democrat himself because he was supporting her in 2008.
Well, what I'm getting at, the thing that I cannot stand about the liberals is that Trump hasn't been in office for 100 days yet. You know, and almost from day one, he's been under attack. Everybody he's been trying to appoint has been under attack.
Yeah, that's true.
And everything from Jeff Sessions to this guy that was that had to resign or got fired or whatever. And it's always been Russia, 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 and all that. You can't govern, period. They just refuse to accept the fact that Hillary Clinton lost.
Yeah.
It's time to move forward. Let the man govern. If you don't like the way he's governing, then do something about it. He's not going anywhere. No, he's not going anywhere.
Hillary isn't going to be in office.
These people that are trying to get him out of office are doing, it's almost, you can vision them laying down on the floor, kicking and screaming and just having temper tantrums.
Yeah.
Because, and you look at every one of them that gets on TV, from Maxine Waters and all these other liberal nuts. Get up there and talk about how it should be impeached, can't support it. And I can't understand, let the man actually do something impeachable before you talk about impeaching the guy.
Well, now they're going after his taxes again. Yeah. You know, I find it funny that Jesse Jackson is out there protesting, you know, in Dallas or wherever, because they want Trump to show his taxes. You know, and I'm thinking the whole time, where's Sharpton?
Yeah, where's that?
He's always next to you. Where's he at? You know, because
tax cheat himself.
Yeah. He's not. This is the first time he wasn't with Jackson that I've seen him in years.
Yeah.
Well, if he's got something in his taxes that is nefarious, okay, then that should have come out when they vetted him or when they.
Any of our business? During
that's just it, though. That it's by law, he does not have to show his income tax.
And if
it
there was something wrong, the IRS would have been on him. Wrong.
Exactly. Yeah, anyway. Exactly.
He'd be going to jail.
Yeah, but, you know, all this would have come out during the primary season and then during the general election. They didn't find anything that was related to his taxes. So let's move on.
Well, here's the thing about that, too. Obama could have done something to have the IRS go after him because of his taxes. You know why I know this? Because he's already done that to people in religions and people in small jobs or small businesses. Remember a couple of years ago when he was going after people for
going
that?
Going after the nonprofits.
So he already had the IRS in his pocket. So if that was the case, he could have gotten Trump on that a long time ago. Which means nothing showed it hasn't worked. They're just trying to take the focus off of their crap.
I don't care about the tax thing. And a lot of Americans don't care. Let's just move this country ahead.
I don't care either.
And I think he's doing the best he can.
With what he can, because he's constantly fighting opposition every step of the way.
Yeah.
And, you know, I disagreed with his Twitter rants
yeah.
in the beginning. But if he tones them down, I don't think it's such a bad thing, because if you expect the media to report on the things that he says, by the time they cut it and splice it and spin it, you know, you don't know what's going to be coming out of their mouths and everything. So, yeah, Twitter is more or less a raw, whether you like it or not, this is what I got to
you
say.
Know, he's the first
form
one.
Form of social media.
He's the first one as president to do so, just like the president during, who was it, Eisenhower and them, that used the media, started the media, TV craze and stuff like that. So, you know, it's no different than that.
What I worry about is, okay, what if he does produce his taxes? That gives CNN and everybody else an opportunity to, let's criticize this, let's criticize that.
No matter what they'll do, they'll find
something.
They'll find
something
to criticize.
You'll see breaking news. So I think he's smart. Why produce a tax if it's going to give the media more meat to eat? So
yeah.
Well,
let's just move on.
There's some things that need to be done in this country. Mm-hmm. Like, for me, the biggest thing is tax reform.
And that's
we
Wednesday.
We got to get tax reform
produce
started.
That Wednesday. Let's see how
so
Wednesday.
We can get this country moving forward.
Yeah.
But you can't, because you got all these other scandals and the Russian involvement in the election and everything like that, which yet they can't prove anything.
Yeah.
There's no substantial or any shred of proof. The Russians.
I saw a thing not too long ago that showed that Podesta was taking money from Russian officials. And Podesta was on Clinton's side. Yeah. So,
see, I look at
the
people.
How do you explain that? The media seemed to stop that.
Who comes home from work with his family and they sit down at the dinner table and all they have is Raymond noodle soup.
The dinner table?
What's Rayman?
The couch. Rayman noodle soup. That's what they're going to have for supper. You think he turns the news on and cares a rat's butt about Putin? He wants his taxes cut. He wants to make more money.
Yeah.
That's the guy that need to focus on, who's sitting in Section 8 housing.
I found out that he was going to pass a bill to open more coal mines that were closed. So.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, and guess
cut
where
back
that's
on the
going.
Regulation.
Guess where the coal is going to go? He's going to ship it to China, and they're going to make money off of it. Exactly. Why smoke our country out? China wants that coal. So let's give the coal miners a job.
Well, see,
let's raise the price of coal.
When you were forcing coal mines.
When you had to open the steel mills back
up,
too.
To shut down, you were forcing coal-powered power plants to shut down. Again, we're talking about an agenda here, a globalist agenda and everything. But if anybody's going to burn coal in the world, you want the U.S. to do it, because the U.S. are the only ones that are going to care to follow every guideline, every restriction, every regulation to make it as clean as possible. Do you think those buttholes over in India or China care about what they're pumping up into the sky? They don't care about that.
Did you see their environmental, how bad their trash problem is over there?
Where?
Have you seen in China?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
That, they had a smog problem recently and everything.
Miles,
well, that's 'cause of the
it's
coal.
Miles of piles of garbage.
And they also have a lot of skyscrapers with nothing in them.
Yeah, yeah. They've actually built cities with no one.
Nothing's in it.
It makes you wonder why.
Yeah.
They have their own
agenda
going on
there again.
Yeah.
You look good, but there's nothing in the
building. I saw that, and I'm thinking, that's disgusting.
I know.
There are people digging in it for food.
Yeah.
It's like, that's disgusting.
And they're having kids in them.
Yeah.
So we can only have my ones. Bottom line is, let the man govern.
That's what I'm saying.
Let's move forward. If you don't like the way he's governing, then vote him out of office when he gets back out.
You're not going to vote him out of office. What they're trying to do is they're trying to hide something. You know, in the last time that happened, the last days of Obama, when all this stuff was coming out, the scandals and the Clinton scandal with their emails, Obama passed a new environmental law, which is a part of that Agenda 21 crap that I read earlier. And I'm thinking, well, this is just more crap.
All presidents kind of do that at the tail end.
Yeah.
They'll, you know, pardon hundreds of people that don't need to be pardoned and everything like that, or pass goofed up regulations or passed new
laws.
That's
what Trump's doing every day. He throws an Obama thing out.
You know, which is fine, because there wasn't Obama a whole lot that Obama did that was...
Obama did it to Bush for
in favor of this
for
country.
6 years. For 6 years, Obama blamed Bush for everything.
No, for 8 years, Obama blamed
well,
Bush.
Well, he changed the blame to something else. I can't remember what it was.
Yeah.
I think it was the Congress wouldn't let him do anything. But he was already doing stuff anyway, whether Congress allowed it or not, such as, you know, the Obamacare. Yeah, that was completely constitutional.
Yeah.
Well,
that
just
was, made it worse.
Justice Roberts.
That thing is horrible.
It just looks like Obama's the library they're going to build is getting smaller and smaller. I think eventually it'll be busted down to a bookmobile.
Yeah, I remember those bookmobiles?
Yeah, bookmobile. Come on
well,
in. Please.
By the time
Make
George
sure
Soros gets finished funding the thing, it's going to be the size of a city block, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I deal with somebody every week that has Medicare, and they deal with that Medicare stuff, and that is the worst that I've ever seen it in my life. Yeah. That is the worst. There's always a complaint, and there's always excuses that they make. From one phone call to another, from one place to another, there's always an issue.
Yeah.
You know, it's because, you know, they said you had insurance, you can go get glasses. You go to the place and say, well, no, we don't cover it over here. Yeah. And then they got to call the city or the state, Medicare, and then they got to call Blue Cross, and then they got to call the doc. I mean, the whole thing is just a freaking mess.
It's just a show.
And
it's
meanwhile, there's a sign on the doctor's office's walls that say, we do not accept Obamacare.
Yeah.
I mean, come on. That thing just, it's a complete disaster now.
Yeah.
I can't see this thing surviving another year, much less 10 years.
Yeah.
I don't understand how they can't pass it or change it. What are they doing?
He needs to get the tax thing fixed first before he can do health care, because that's the penalty people are having to pay for not having insurance.
Yeah.
He has to work on that tax thing.
Well,
I like his idea. Trump has an idea that's...
Oh, it'll be shot down by the Democrats, no doubt.
The one where if you have a serious illness or serious... problem, if you're terminally ill, whatever, that comes out of a different pot than what you and I have to pay for insurance. We don't have to make up for that. So I like that idea. I mean, I don't think people who are terminally ill should be cut.
Well, I don't like the idea of any kind of mandate for anything. Now, granted, the pre-existing conditions and leaving your kids on your plan until they're 26, that sounds all peachy and rosy and everything like that. But let's be practical here.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, if you have a car and you're driving around and you get into an accident, you're not going to be able to pick up the phone and say, Mr. Allstate, I need to buy insurance. Okay. Thank you. Well, I got to send you a bill because I just had an accident.
Yeah.
Before I joined your thing. So let me send you a bill. And Mr. Allstate will hang up on you and tell you, no, it doesn't work like that. But yet we're expecting our health insurance companies to do the same thing.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to be cold-hearted or anything like that.
Oh, I am.
But for you to expect people to cover pre-existing conditions, and let's be realistic, who under... the current guidelines and everything, who's going to be buying insurance? Only the people who are sick.
Yeah.
And everything. The healthy people, the young healthy people are going to buy or are going to pay the penalty. They would rather do that instead of pay a $400 or $500 a month premium. I'll just pay the $2,000 penalty or whatever it is at the end of the year because I never go to the doctor.
Not to mention...
So you're going to have a whole bunch of people that are healthy that are supposed to balance out the people with pre-existing conditions.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
That
he's
aren't
cut out. If you're a pre-existing condition, you're going to be put in a different group. You're not. The regular Joe is not going to have to pay for somebody in pre-existing condition.
It irritates me.
I like that idea.
It irritates me that you keep paying and paying and paying and paying, and then when you get sick, oh, we're sorry, we can't have you unless you pay $8,000 on a deductible. I'm like, really?
That's intentional. I've got an $8,000.
That's
deductible.
That's intentional, so you can't use it, you can't spend it, and they can keep taking money from you. I might as well just hand them my wallet. and not even do the paperwork.
No, there's nothing in it.
I prefer
well, not now.
more of a, let's say a like a discounted cash rate by going to a doctor or having a hospital or something like that, to where you can pull out of an HSA, where you can pull out of a health savings account.
Yeah,
instead of paying insurance premiums, you pay into a health savings account, and when you have to go to the doctor, you go to the doctor and you pay out of there. And the doctors almost, from what I've hear, what I hear, if you tell you're paying cash, I got cash right here, they'll almost automatically give you a lower, lower rate.
Whole Foods,
charge you less.
Whole Foods, the company Whole Foods, they do that. They have an account that you put money into, and it's like a pool.
It's called a cafeteria plan.
And it's a pool of money that the employees put into, and if something happens, they take money out of that pool to
help
their
employees.
Well, the cafeteria
plan I was in, if you didn't use it, you got it back.
Yeah.
As long as you did it.
Well, it's like an HSA,
Well, they spoke to one employee through Whole Foods and said he paid for his wife's birth and all the other stuff.
Yeah.
Through that pool, and it was much better than the insurance plan that they were
using.
That
should be a choice. So. That should be a choice I should have, because I'm not expecting to run up expenses.
Now, well, if you force the individuals, I don't want to use the word force, but if you make it to where the individuals have to pay out of their own pocket, say from a health savings account, every time they go to the doctor, they're going to cut back on the amount of times they go to the doctor. And every little sniffle, you're going to say, well, maybe I don't really need to go to the doctor and spend a couple $100. Maybe I'd just, go for something a little more catastrophic or a little more serious.
Mm-hmm.
I'll go buy my whatever at the drugstore to try to get over this cold or flu and move on.
Yeah.
But when you have people that make no money, that are given health care or make very little money, and then or given a health plan that's $40 a month, they're going to be at the doctor every time they can. And that's going to make the people who aren't on the exchanges have to pick up the slack. It's because the healthy people aren't paying for insurance. They're paying the penalty.
It's another way of collapsing the system. Yep. Another way. Well, it's
they call that distribution of wealth.
Yeah.
Obama liked that kind
of
stuff.
Of course.
And we need to drop the price of pills and doctor visits and all that. That's ridiculous what they're charging people. Absolutely ridiculous.
I don't disagree
ridiculous.
With that, but.
Share the wealth. Yeah. All right. Got to get out of here, guys, because it's getting late. And And then show is over. I got to find my closers. Yeah. Something like that. So. Anyway, I don't know why I did.
Anyway,
that.
So
yeah, yeah.
Okay, we're buying.
Well, they say all good things come to an end.
What's that got to do with this show?
If you were offended, then we've done our job.
Like your panties.
It's a joke, Jay. It's all.
That's not a joke. That is a severe behavioral disorder. Those are women's underpants.
We're live with the Ghostgetter.
I want to thank everybody for coming here tonight. Till next week for the Mike Ghostgetter Show. The Nightbreed Show. Wix.com/Ghostgetter. Check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and also on YouTube. Keyword Ghostgetter on there as well. Yeah. Find us on there. That's where our show archives are going to be through the weekend. Till next week from the Ghostgetter and Patreon.com/Ghostgetter as well. See ya.